Hi, it's Tarrant.
And Stella from Meeple University.
Today we'll be teaching you how to play Hadrian's Wall, and hopefully you will be able to play this game after watching the video coming up. Let's learn how to play Hadrian's Wall, game designed by Bobby Hill and published by Garfield Games.
Let's get to the table.
Set during the expansion of the Roman Empire to Great Britain during the 2nd century, Hadrian's Wall is a pen and paper game of Roman society. Players will manage resources and workers as they build the fortress of Hadrian's Wall to prevent against the invading Pict armies, as well as developing 5 different facets of Roman society, all in the aim of gaining victory points. The player who gains the most points after 6 rounds and 6 invasions by the Picts will win the game. To set up the game, each player takes a 2-part player board, a deck of 12 cards in player colour, which are shuffled and set to the side, 2 player sheets, one representing the fort and one representing society, and a pen. Someone should shuffle the fate deck, ready for its use in the game. If you are playing with 1 or 2 players, you'll also prepare a neutral player deck, but we'll talk more about that at the end of the video. Finally, the players collectively determine whether they'll be playing the easy, medium, or hard mode, and this determines how many Picts invade at the end of each round. You're now ready to play. At the start of each round, first turn up the top fate card, face up into the middle of the table for all players to see. This determines the 8 resources that all players will gain at the start of this round. These will be among the game's 5 basic types of resources: soldiers, builders, servants, civilians, and resources. Players may gain additional income at this stage based on anything they've unlocked in this section of their board to this point in the game. This can be more building resources for resource production, it could be yellow or blue workers, or it could be victory points, but more on all of those later. Next, each player draws the top 2 cards from their player deck, looks at them, and then simultaneously chooses one to play face up and one to slip under their player board, like so. The card under the player board shows an endgame objective worth up to 3 victory points, and by the end of the game you'll have 6 of those. This gives you something to work towards, but has no other effect. For the card you play face up onto the table, gain the resources shown in this box in the bottom left corner of the card. These are added to everything else you've gained so far. All cards played for their resources should be left face up, visible, and with the player who played them throughout the round, as the rest of the information on the card may be important. Once all players have done this, you may proceed to the actions phase, which all players may complete simultaneously. Before we go through all of the different actions, let's take a moment to familiarize ourselves with the player sheets. The left sheet represents your fortress as well as your points, and the right sheet represents your society. The bottom of your fort board is your scoring area. You won't be taking any actions down here, but it contains your 4 main scoring tracks: renown, piety, valor, and discipline, as well as showing the icons that represent those points. Anytime you score a point of a given type, you will cross out the next leftmost box in that track, possibly gaining a bonus when you cross off a space containing a bonus. Each track is limited to 25, and so if you specialise, you'll unlock some good bonuses at the end, but if you over-specialise, you will lose any excess points you might have gained. The top half of your fortress board represents your fortress, including the fort and then all of the extra fortifications, the wall, tipi, and the wall guard, as well as forestry and mining happening out beyond the wall. The very top of your board represents your 3 cohorts, which is your true defence against the Picts. You'll need to build some level of defence on all 3 of these cohorts, because the fate cards will tell you which one the Picts will attack through. The centre of your fortress board represents some of the actions and structures that you can build. Your society board is broken into two main areas, the citizen tracks and the buildings. There are five different citizen tracks, the traders, performers, priests, apparitores, and patricians. And to the immediate right of each, and showing the same colour, are the buildings associated with that type of citizen. Each action in the game is represented by one of these tan arrows, which shows the name of the action, and then the cost or prerequisites for taking it. For example, the cost here for the fort would be a blue or a black worker. This would be taken from your inventory and then returned to the main supply. Sometimes the cost to take an action may be an icon. This one, for example, is the hammer icon. There are no physical hammer resources in the game, and so taking an action with this cost would require you to take an action elsewhere, which gives you that icon. Many actions also show a banner with a number as either the prerequisite or part of the cost. To do this, you would need to have reached that number on the corresponding banner. So here it's an orange infrastructure banner of 2, which would require reaching at least this point on the infrastructure and 4. Finally, most of the actions you take in the game simply involve crossing out the next box from left to right on a certain track. And where that's not the case, I will point that out. Anytime you cross out any icon, you immediately gain the resource or the other effect of that icon. As such, the major puzzle of this game is in chaining as many actions together as possible, using one resource to gain another, and another, and so on. So with that, let's look at each of the actions in detail. We'll start with the fort, which is a fundamental place to begin. Here, you spend either a builder or a soldier to cross the next step from left to right on the fort. This will primarily earn you citizens as rewards, as well as advance you on the orange infrastructure track, which is critical for building all of these buildings a little bit below the fort. The fort also allows you to build the wall and the tzipi. As you can see, each box on both of those lines is chained to a box on the fortress row, and you are not allowed to fill in a box on either the wall or tzipi before you've filled in the chained box on the fort. The wall and the tzipi both cost building resources to construct, and again you'll spend one building resource and then fill in the next box as long as you've filled in its connected chain. These are also a good way to gain civilians, as well as renown points and steps on your cohorts. When you gain the cohort icon, which is this red shield, then you may cross out the leftmost open box in any one of your 3 cohorts, like so. This is critical for defending against the Picts. The wall guard is the other way to gain cohort in the game, and the primary way of doing this is to spend a soldier to simply cross out the next step on the wall guard track, again from left to right, and again giving you cohort when you cross out the red shield. These are not chained to your fort, and so your wall guard may advance beyond your fort. Soldiers are the hardest of the workers to come by, and so another way to gain wall guard is by gaining the sword icon, which can be done at the training grounds, where you train a builder into a soldier. To use the training grounds, spend your builder, cross out the sword icon, taking the bonus up at the wall guard, and then write the number of the current year into this box. You are only allowed to use the training grounds once per year, and so writing the number helps to keep track of this. The other action in your fortress area is the mining and foresting action, where you must spend one servant to cross the next box in your mining and foresting track. This is one of the two ways in the game that you can gain resource production, which is the hammer icon. And when you get a hammer icon, you fill in the next circle on your resource production track, as well as gaining a resource immediately. This makes sure you have a good supply of building resources at the start of each year, and you are going to need to go up on this track if you want to keep building the amount of buildings that you'd like to. All 5 of these actions are restricted by the size of your granary. At the start of the game, you have a small granary, and that means you are allowed to build as far as this line on all five of those tracks. You may not build beyond that until you have constructed the medium granary. This will cost you a purple worker, a blue worker, a building resource, and you must be at least infrastructure level 1. Once you take that action, fill in this circle and you are allowed to build as far as this line on those 5 actions. To go beyond there requires the large granary, which requires infrastructure 5, a servant, a builder, and 2 building resources. When you complete that, fill in the circle and fill in this box here, scoring a renown point. Any time you see 2 boxes separated by a plus, you will cross them out at the same time. Just to be clear, the restrictions on the granaries refer only to these 5 lines. It does not refer to the cohort, and from the very start of the game, you may build in whichever cohort you wish. We now move to the middle part of the board, which is where you're constructing most of your infrastructure. These 3, the hotels, workshops, and roads, work in much the same way. You must have reached the minimum infrastructure level, and then you spend the number of servants, builders, or building resources to fill in the next circle, and the square gaining the immediate bonus. Additionally, to build the large version of a building, you must have first built the small version, a rule which is true across all buildings in the game. Each hotel will grant you an extra civilian at the start of each round, each workshop will grant you an extra builder at the start of each round, and each road grants you 1 point on whichever of the 4 victory point tracks you wish at the start of each round. The small road also grants you an immediate piety or discipline point, and the large road grants you an immediate renown or valour. The forum is one of the game's more inefficient actions, but it's there if you really need it. It allows you to exchange any 2 workers for any 1 other worker. This is restricted to once per year, so once you've gained the bonus, again, mark the current year so that you know not to use it again. However, be warned that the forum is not for soldiers. You can't exchange soldiers, and you can't gain them by taking the forum action. The last action on the fort board is to construct a landmark, and these are relatively cheap points, but they're not going to be open to you till near the end of the game. To build a landmark, you must have reached the landmark banner on the corresponding victory point track. So here, the archway would be open to the player because the player has reached 15 points on the renown track. Then simply spend a builder and 2 building resources to construct the landmark and gain 2 of the corresponding points. So with that, we'll now go to the society board. Your society board has 5 different citizen tracks: the traders, performers, priests, apparitores, and patricians, as well as the buildings associated with those citizens. The cost to advance on any one of these 5 citizen tracks is a civilian, which is the yellow worker. And through the game, you'll also find that this is the primary function for your yellow workers. Each of the 5 tracks also has its own icon, in roughly the same colour, and you'll be able to advance on that track when unlocking the matching icon somewhere else on the board. Advancing on the different citizen tracks will give you a nice influx of workers or victory points, but will also unlock these banners, which are prerequisites for those citizens' buildings. Each of the coloured banners unlocks the ability to construct a new building. However, even the beige banners could be a prerequisite. Here you would need to have reached level 5 on the traders track, which is this beige banner here, to take that specific action. So with that, let's look at each of the different buildings in the society side of the game. The traders may build precincts or the market. The precincts are very simple. Simply pay the cost and then gain the victory point and resource production shown. The precincts are the only place in the game, other than the mining and foresting action, where you can gain resource production. As another reminder, in all types of buildings where there are different sizes, you must build the smallest before working your way up to the largest. The market is a way of getting victory points from your excess resources. Before you can use any of the actions inside the market, you must first build the market, which costs you these two workers, these resources, but gains you a renown point. Once you've done that, you can use any of the action spaces in the market up to your current banner position on the trader's track. To take a market action, you must meet the prerequisite and spend one building resource. Then determine which trade good you want. Trade goods are represented by this carpet icon, which is present on the player cards as well as on the fate cards. These are numbered between 1 and 6, with 1 being the most common and 6 the least. You will have 3 choices of trade goods when you take this action. These will be the ones showing on the player cards of your neighbours to the left and right, or you could choose to turn the top card from the fate deck and take whatever goods are showing there. You can't take from your own player card. If you choose one of the goods from a neighbour, you give the resource that you spend to that neighbour. If you take from the fate deck, then you return that good to the supply. Then write that trade good number into the corresponding hexagon space in your market. Players should also note that the most valuable trade goods come on the player cards that give you the most valuable resources, and so be careful what you're leaving open to your neighbours if they're going in on the market. You do not need to fill these in a specific order, as long as you meet the prerequisites. If this is a new type of goods for you that you didn't previously have in your market, then you gain a number of renown points based on the total number of types of goods you have. So your first, second, and third unique goods types would each give you 1 renown point. Your fourth and fifth unique types of goods will earn you 2 points each, and your sixth unique type will give you 3 points. This means there's 10 renown points on offer for getting every type of trade goods into your market. If you gain a type of goods which you've already had before, you gain no points. But there may still be benefit to doing that, as these last two spaces will give you an extra worker, and the merchant endgame objective will give you another point if you can get all the way up to 8 goods. The performers offer 2 buildings, the theatre and the Ludus Gladiatoris, and once again you must construct the building before you're able to use the actions of that building. At the theatre, you spend 1 resource and must meet the prerequisite of the banner in order to take a performance. You may do these in any order, as long as you meet the prerequisite. To take the action, simply cross in the box, take the resources you've crossed out, and then write the current year number into this box. This is because you may only do 1 performance per round. At the Ludus Gladiatoris, you'll be training up gladiators and then sending them into battle. To take the action, spend either a servant or a civilian in order to circle the next one of these gladiator icons from the left. You may train either the red or the blue gladiator, or both at the same time, as long as you spend 1 worker per circle. You must meet the column's prerequisite in order to fill in that circle. Immediately after training a gladiator, you may optionally send it into battle. You may do this once per year per gladiator, and so list the current year in the gladiator's column. Then, draw and flip over the top card of the fate deck and fill in as many circles from left to right on that gladiator's track as shown in this icon. So here you would fill in 1 circle. This will be a number between 1 and 3. If that gladiator has any circles remaining which are not filled in, then the gladiator won the fight. You immediately gain renown points based on this row in the column of the gladiator's last circle. So this gladiator would gain 2 renown points. It also lives to fight again next year, possibly gaining those same points over and over. On the other hand, if all of the gladiator's circles are filled in during the fight, then the gladiator has died. The gladiator still gains points, but this time they're piety points equal to the column of that gladiator's final circle. A gladiator gains more piety the earlier in its career it's killed, but once a gladiator has been killed, you will no longer be allowed to train or fight with that gladiator. Effectively, any remaining spaces on that gladiator are not available. The priests can build two types of buildings: gardens, for which there is small and large, and temples, which come in small, medium, and large. There are a lot of piety points on offer for completing the priest's buildings. The gardens are very simple. You will pay the resources and then cross out this large box, gaining all of the bonuses shown here. And this is a piety point, and then advancement on three of the citizen tracks. The large garden is even stronger, giving you a piety and an advancement on all five tracks. When you construct a temple, you gain a piety point and then unlock the action for that temple. These give you a way to spend workers in order to gain more piety points as well as protection. For each of these temple tracks, as long as you meet the prerequisite, spend any worker to fill in the first box, and then spend any worker to fill in the second box, which gets you a piety point and one protection. This will come in handy when the Picts are attacking. So when you gain it, circle it, and then you'll fill it in if you later use it in the game. The Apparitores have two buildings that they can construct: the baths and the courthouse. At the baths, you can bribe people to forget about your failures when it comes to defending against the Picts. Since we haven't spoken about Pict attacks yet, I'm going to leave this action till later. The other building is the courthouse, and once it's built, this is a good place to gain additional workers. You may use the left column to simply gain a purple worker. You may use the middle column to spend a builder in order to gain two purple workers. And in the right column, you may exchange a purple worker for a blue worker. As usual, there is a prerequisite for using each of these actions based on the Apparitore's track. And for these particular actions, you may only use one action per column per year. Here again, you keep track of this by writing the current round number into the box when you activate it. The final citizen track is the Patricians, and this is the only one of the citizen tracks which requires you to spend soldiers to do the actions. Here you can send soldiers away as diplomats or as scouts. To send away a diplomat, simply spend the cost and then cross out this valor point to gain a valor, and then circle these two protections here. These are the same as what we saw at the temple, where they will protect you from a Pict attack. However, you must also choose up front whether the diplomat is protecting the left, center, or right cohort by circling. If you have multiple diplomats in the game, each must serve a different cohort. Once again, we'll see how this works when we talk about the Pict attack. The final action is to scout, and it costs you one soldier and allows you to cross off a horse. Now, refer to the player cards that you and your neighbours to the left and right chose for resources this round. You're going to cross off one of those three Tetris shapes in your scouting grid. If you choose your own, return the soldier that you spent to the supply. If you choose a neighbour's, give that neighbour your soldier. Then, with the freedom to flip or rotate however you wish, cross out that Tetris shape in your grid, gaining the bonuses for any squares that you fill, and gaining one valor point for each row that you completely fill up. If you scout five times through the game and the right shapes come up, you'll be able to completely fill this grid. And so, with the exception of the baths, which we'll come back to shortly, that is all of the actions available to you in Hadrian's Wall. It's important to get a quick sense for what the different sorts of workers are going to do for you in this game. The yellow workers are your civilians, and in almost all cases, they're going to be advancing you on the citizen tracks. The blue workers are your builders, and they're going to be pivotal in constructing your buildings and your fort. Black workers are the soldiers, and they are primarily used in the wall guard or the scouting actions. Purple workers are your servants. They're often assigned to help other workers with their actions, as well as being sent out into the mines and forests as part of your resource production. And your resources are also used as part of your buildings, as well as building the wall and trading in certain buildings. prior to the Pict attack, if you have any leftover resources or workers that you haven't spent, you discard them. It's very much in your interest to use everything you've got during the round. So now that we understand that, let's see what happens when Picts attack. To resolve the Pict attack, draw a number of cards from the Fate deck based on your difficulty and current year. So for a medium difficulty game in round 3, for example, you would draw 4 Fate cards. These 4 cards are placed face up in the middle of the table and apply to all players. Refer only to the top part of the card. This shows you whence the Picts will be invading. Here, 2 Picts attack through the left and 2 Picts attack through the centre. Each player then checks their cohort to see how many Picts break through. Here, the left cohort has 2 defence and therefore defends them successfully, while the centre cohort has only 1 defence, and so 1 Pict is let through. If a player does let any Picts through, but has a favour or protection marker circled at the temples, then that player may cross that off in order to ignore 1 Pict. Do note though that these are single use, and that at the diplomat you have chosen which cohort it must be protecting. These 2 here could not be used to protect against that centre Pict invasion. Players then either gain valour points or disdain, which is worth negative points, based on how successful they were at defending the Picts. To work this out, look at the grey banner of your current year. Here it was a 2. For each Pict which was not defended, up to a maximum of that grey banner, gain 1 disdain. Then for whatever is left, gain valour. So here, if you let 1 out of 4 Picts through, you would gain 1 disdain and 1 valour. While in a hard final year, as another example, if you defended against 9 of the 12 Picts and let 3 through, you would get 3 disdain and then 1 valour to make up to 4. On the other hand, if you let 7 of the Picts through, you would still gain only 4 disdain. Valour points are gained by crossing them off on your valour track, and if you gain a soldier as a bonus, you will have that at the start of the next round. Any disdain you get is circled but not filled in on this track here. Disdain will be worth negative points at the end of the game, and once you've got it, the only way to get rid of it is to take the bribe action at the baths. To take this, spend the resources shown, cross out the thumbs up arrow, and then write the current year number into the box. This is because you can take a maximum of 2 bribe actions per round, and again, this helps you keep track. Each bribe you make allows you to fill in one of these circles, and at that point it will no longer count towards your negative score. Once the 6th Pict attack is finished, the game is over. Any soldiers you gain as part of a valour reward during that 6th attack are simply wasted, as there are no longer any actions to use them on. Then proceed to endgame scoring. First, you will score points based on your position on each of these tracks, reading from the flags at the bottom of the track. Next, you'll score points based on how well you've completed each of the 6 objectives you chose during the game. Each objective will be worth between 0 and 3 points. The fighter scores for cohorts you've completely filled in. The vanguard scores for sections of the wall guard you've completed. The defender scores completed sections of the wall. The forager scores based on your resource production. The architect scores your constructed landmarks. And the aristocrat scores your final disdain. The merchant scores for your number of trade goods. The trainer scores the total strength of your gladiators, dead or alive. The pontiff scores your completed temples. And the ranger scores filled columns on your scout grid. The planner scores completed citizen tracks. And the engineer scores constructed large buildings across both boards. Finally, count your final disdain, and then lose a number of points based on the banner shown. The player with the highest score wins. In the event of a tie, whoever has the lowest disdain wins, and if still tied, whoever scored the most from path cards wins. If still tied, victory is shared. When playing with 1 or 2 players, you need to make a small change to the game by using neutral cards in order to give you more options for trade goods and scouting. In setup, shuffle one neutral deck. Then, at the start of each round, in a two-player game, you'll flip one card face up, and in a one-player game, you'll flip two cards face up. These two trade goods will be part of your options at the market, and these two Tetrises will be part of your choice when scouting. When one of the players in the game uses one of the neutral cards for its scouting or its trading, the resource goes onto the card rather than back to the supply. Then, when resolving the Pict attack, you will draw one additional fate card for each resource which is on a neutral card. In other words, trading with a neutral player results in more Picts attacking. There are no other changes for the two-player game, and in the solo game, you'll compare your final score against this table on page 22 of the rulebook. And that's how to play Hadrian's Wall. We hope you enjoyed this video and we hope it helps you.
If this video has been helpful, you can please help us by hitting that like button. Subscribe to us, you can also hit the meeple in the corner to do so, and hit the bell icon so you'll be one of the first to know when we have new and exciting videos. You can also follow me on Instagram for my board games journey.
And if you have any questions, comments, or feedback, please write them in the comment section below.
Until next time!